But first, let's deal with some of the stuff. Anything that's happened since I've been away?
That I had a secure roof over my head of public housing, which was council owned, but I had that security, and that gave me and my mum that security of a start in life.
We've said that our priority is cost of living.
With Australia in the middle of a housing crisis, the Prime Minister has defended his new multi-million dollar investment.
Anthony Albanese is the proud new owner of a Central Coast beach house worth more than $4 million.
What? The Housing Commission guy has found more money down the back of the lounge to be able to buy an even bigger investment property than he had before. Geez, times are good if you happen to be at that end of the plane, the private plane, if you will. You know this one, you've heard it all day. And by the way, the smart Alex will turn around saying Sky News mentioned it six times. Look, we're all separate shows, okay? But as if this isn't worth mentioning. $4.3 million. Wasn't the one he was selling 1.9? So I don't know where the extra money comes from, but wow. Now, the Prime Minister had a few little crack at this about how to explain this pretty tone-deaf moment. And I'll explain to those that are saying nothing to see here why this is the tone-deaf moment. This is the Prime Minister explaining how it was really important that despite the fact that he doesn't plan to go anywhere anytime soon, he's got two taxpayer-funded mansions, he had to buy this one. Roll the tape.
I'm planning to be in my current job for a very long period of time.
OK, so it's not because he's planning to retire. So why would you put your head in the proverbial lion's mouth of how this looks? It wasn't because he had to spend more time with his family. It wasn't because he had to choose family over work. No, it's just because he could. Again.
Well, Jody and I are getting married, as is known, and I'm pleased about that. And Jody's a coastie. She's a proud coastie. She's as proud of being a coastie as Jim is here of being a Logan. Lifelong resident. There are three generations of Haydens on the coast there, and when your relationship changes, your life changes and you make decisions. But what I'm focused on is making sure that everyone can get a roof over their head. I'm focused on increased public housing and social housing investment.
So the wedding, which, remember, we were told was put off until after the next election. So if you're not planning to live in the house and you don't need to live in the house and she was a coastie before and she's going to be a coastie after, again, just because you can is the reason why he made the decision that he did to buy the house. Now, we've spoken before about people who have money in politics versus those that don't, but when you've made a virtue of pretending that you're not like everyone else and you're actually worse than many, if not everyone else, in terms of how tone-deaf you are, that's why this becomes the story, the thing worth mentioning, the reason we're talking again tonight. Now, remember, by the way, this bloke has two taxpayer-funded mansions. That's why the purchasing of extra homes behind the scenes, while presumably, and obviously, he's not paying the mortgage of the lodge or Kirribilli House, so he's able to take his entire wage and throw it towards potentially a mortgage of a property that's twice as much as the one that apparently he's been selling. Now, again, would you and I do the deal? Yes, probably on a financial level. But when you're a politician, you know it's not just about how it is, it's about how it looks, and how it looks is bloody awful. Also, again, so, OK, third bite at the Prime Minister trying to explain exactly what the heck is going on here and about why there's nothing to see, that he still is the boy who understands what it's like to struggle because he's just worked so damn hard and he's that damn good.
Of course, I am much better off. As a Prime Minister, I earn a good income. I understand that. I understand that I've been fortunate. But I also know what it's like to struggle. My mum lived in the one public housing that she was born in for all of her 65 years. And I know what it's like, which is why I want to help all Australians into a home, whether it be public homes or private rentals or home ownership.
Now, I'm going to say the quiet bit out loud. If this bloke had somehow built a business outside of politics and found a way for that business to continue, but he was all arm's length through trusts and all the rest of it, then OK, we understand what's going on here. We understand that, yes, it's his right as a private citizen to buy, a private citizen to buy and sell what he wants. But this bloke is only financially able to buy a $4 and a bit million holiday house because he's worked for us for decades. That's weird. According to the Australian Parliament House biography section, where you can check every single MP and what they're willing to tell you about their life before politics, here's what it says about Albo. It says, of course, that he left Sydney University. He then worked as a bank officer, otherwise known as a teller, for 12 months. There's then a missing 4 years, and from 1985 to 2024, he's worked for the government. He worked as an advisor to a federal government minister. He's worked for the party while doing so. He's worked as an advisor to the former Premier of New South Wales. In 1996, he eventually became an MP, as which he has been to this very day. What I find amazing about all of this is that you can see so many parts of the media, particularly the television media, they did not really want to do this today. And a perfect example is, and I'll post the whole story up for you on the Facebook page, the Channel 9 treatment of this story was as pro-Albo as you could possibly get. Not to mention the fact that they ran it, not in the first break, not in the second break, but after sport and at about 7 minutes before the end of the bulletin when most people had gone. And in terms of the number of questions the Prime Minister got about this, well, that's the bit that's interesting as well. You see, he received just 3 questions about this. Just 3. As best as I could tell, they were often from the same place. And the amazing reason why I'm saying they only asked 3 questions about it was because the very reason for the press conference was about building more social housing on the day when you want to focus on the people who have the least. You are one of the ones who has the most, supposedly pretending to be the new style politician who's going to lift everyone up. Well, mate, the only person who's being lifted up is you, by us. Because you don't have to pay a single dollar for a single thing in one of 2 private mansions that you have right now. And just to drive home why I am annoyed about this, it's not because Anthony Albanese's financially doing better than the rest of us. It's not because Anthony Albanese's playing 4D chess and he's somehow getting into our heads for free. It's because the reality in Australia today, 2 news stories from today, is that there are a lot of people on the bones of their backside. Now, poor people have not been invented under this government, but they got worse under this mob. So you would think that the Prime Minister would have a little bit of self-control as opposed to just playing like no one's looking or assuming that if anyone looks, no one will turn a blind eye or no one will turn a judging eye to his actions. Today, Labor faces backlash over housing affordability crisis as concerns mount over falling standards of living. A Redbridge poll, which is done also in conjunction with the organisation Accent, people are asked, do you think home ownership is attainable for young people without family assistance? 3/4 of the country in every state said no. Now, parents of a very dear friend of mine, we got the chance to chat every now and then, and they said that whoever came up with some sort of policy to make sure that their kid could buy a house, regardless of whether it's Team Red, Team Blue or Team Green, they're probably going to flip that way. Look back again at this, right, because I'm going to go on the state by state, right? Let's start in Queensland and work our way around. 77% of people say no without bank of mum and dad in Queensland. The same in New South Wales, 76 in Victoria, 77 in the ACT, 76 in Tasmania, 77 nationally, 76 in Western Australia, 79 in the Northern Territory. Nowhere in this list does more than 15% of people say people are able to buy a house without the assistance of mum and dad. That's why today it mattered that the Prime Minister, who is overseeing a system that has that result, decides to spend twice as much on his next holiday house or next investment property as he did in his last investment property, from 1.9 and now 4 point something. That is just rubbing people's face in it. It really is. It's his right to do it. He can legally do it. Nobody's going to get him to resign. But this bloke is either on a death wish like Malcolm Turnbull, where he does not care or does not know and is just running off the cliff, or he's so high on his own supply and his ego is so through the roof that he thinks it doesn't matter, that no one will notice, and the only people who do notice are nasty buggers like me or people who are never going to vote for him like many watching this program. Second story about why this is the Prime Minister delivering a giant FU to millions of Australians today. And then when asked about it, barely by the press or barely reported by some television networks. Why this is just rubbing salt in the wounds. No longer a crisis of temporary hardship. Grim warning as Aussies report skipping food for days due to cost of living. The man who is the Prime Minister, who is most responsible and therefore in charge of a system and a country that is having this result, decided to go and buy a new property he doesn't need. Because she's a coach. I mean, come on, please. Really? Imagine how they would have reacted if this was a Liberal. Let's go through the story, because I have quoted one statistic to you for a very long period of time, and there's a new version of it tonight. Australians are going entire days without food as a hunger relief charity issues a stark warning. Paying attention? Nearly 50% of households earning less than $30,000 are experiencing food insecurity. Repeat. Nearly 50% of households earning less than $30,000 are experiencing food insecurity. This comes from my mates at Food Bank and the Food Bank Hunger Report. In 2024, 32% of Australian households, that's 3.4 million households, experienced food insecurity. That means the Prime Minister, who's got enough cash to be able to turn his $1.9 million investment property into a $4.3 million holiday house, good luck to him, but the people watching that tonight on the news, 32% of Australian households, 3.4 million people, do not know where their food's going to come from. Oh, I got more. The report also found that more than half of households affected by food insecurity are often skipping meals or going entire days without food. So while you're buying the new joint, the new holiday house for when eventually either Australia, the Labor Party, or you yourself choose to walk off the stage, you'll be right, pal. But you know, 3.4 million people who supposedly you understand, you empathise, that's where you grew up, that's where Mum lived her entire life, you couldn't care less. Why do I know that to be the case? Because this federal government spends more money, more taxpayers' money, advertising its own political schemes than it does supporting organisations like Food Bank. We showed you their budget submission, where Food Bank, Second Bite, other organisations that get together trying to take care of this very issue of people who can't feed themselves, they asked for $45 million collectively when it comes to the budget. This government is spending just $40 million alone flogging the too little too late tax cuts, let alone another $20 million on the Made in Australia stuff. Automatically, two policies, two bits of government slash political advertising that dwarf the entire amount of money that this Prime Minister could decide to send the way of those who don't have enough food to eat. But because his assumption is that the greater Australians do not care about the poor, or they always assume that the poor exists, while at the same time, three quarters of Australians say that their kid would not be able to buy a house without their financial support. And if you don't have the financial support of mum and dad who own a joint, or nana and papa who own a joint, then you're stuffed. Oh, but she's a coastie. Three quick numbers I'm going to show you. 97% of the families in this survey who have food insecurity worry that the food's going to run out before they've got enough money to buy it. He's got a brand new house that he's not going to move into. He's going to rent out. He's going to live off the cream. $4.3 million. That's why it's a bad news day. Those in some food insecurity who can't afford balanced meals, meaning they're eating crap, junk food, garbage, 93%. Severely food insecure households where adults don't eat so their kids can, 97%. Percent of the millions of people, 3 and a bit million people, who can't eat. This year, 45% Some months, not every month. Cut back on what they eat so their kids can eat. 44%, they do cut back every month so their kid can eat. That's why I'm paid off. That's why it's a story. That's why we lead the show with it, because it is the ultimate manifestation of a man who just says things about the poor. While the poor get poorer, while the hungry get hungrier, where the homeless stay as far away from accommodation as possible, where three quarters of the country believe they're not possible for the person that they love, as much as the Prime Minister loves his family, for them to be able to buy a house unless somehow financially things work for them. This is the same Prime Minister who promised us something very different. Reality, it's all worse. He rubs salt into the wounds, the protection racket in the media. Oh, we'll report it, but quick, change the subject. Three questions today. That's it, three. I guarantee it'll be zero tomorrow, because we couldn't possibly have back-to-back bad news days for the greatest Prime Minister of all time, after all. Way back when he used to be poor, now he's stinking rich.